program coordinator at Mining Watch Canada, and we're really honored. And we're putting on the event here tonight in collaboration with the Latin America and Caribbean Studies program here at Carleton University. And so shout out to Christian for all the help in getting this happening. Just a really brief introduction to our guests and the visit of this delegation to Ottawa this week. We're accompanied today by Jose Luis Abarca, the son of Mariano Abarca, who was a community leader in Chicumusal in Chiapas, who was murdered in November of 2009, by Libertad Diaz from Otros Mundos Chiapas, a civil society organization in Chiapas that has accompanied the struggle against the negative impacts of a barite mine owned by a Canadian mining company, Blackfire Exploration. And since the assassination of Mariano, has closely accompanied the family in their struggle for justice for this crime. Miguel Angel de los Santos is a lawyer and coordinator of the Human Rights Center at the Autonomous University of Chiapas. He's the family's lawyer in Chiapas and has been representing them in their efforts with the public prosecutor's office there and in a complaint against the Mexican state for the violation of the right to life and justice of Mariano Abarca and his family that had been brought towards the Inter-American Human Rights Commission. And Miguel Mijangos is from the organization Comprehensive Processes for Self-Determination for People's Self-Determination, works in Oaxaca and Guerrero, Mexico, and he's here in representation of the Mexican Network of Mining Affected People. A broad-based network with participation from numerous states across Mexico where communities are struggling to resist mining and to demand accountability for the negative impacts of that activity on their lives and lands. This delegation has come to Ottawa this week with a very specific objective in mind, which has been to bring a complaint to the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner. An office that probably few of us know very much about. I certainly know that I didn't know very much about it until this past year in our efforts with the Abarca family and all of these organizations to not only seek justice for the responsible actors in Mexico for the murder of Mariano Abarca, but also the Canadian connection. And there's numerous Canadian connections. All of the suspects in this assassination are in one way or another connected to the Canadian company, Blackfire Exploration. But we've also, through access to information requests, and I'm really happy to have Ken Rubin here tonight, who's an access to information warrior, and a remarkable researcher who's helped us out on this front. To unearth documents from foreign affairs to really understand the extent of communication and connection between the Canadian Embassy in Mexico and Blackfire Exploration before and throughout the duration of their operations in Chiapas to pretty much unilaterally back the company at every stage despite considerable knowledge about the conflict, the protests, the discontent in the community, and then the growing threats to Mariano Abarca and others. And even with that knowledge, shored up and backed up the company's interests at every turn. And we'll hear a bit more about that when we hear from Jose Luis and Miguel Angel de los Santos. We just want to start things off, though, with a really short video, a tribute to Mariano and to the ongoing struggle for justice, and then we'll hear from our speakers. So, should we turn off the light, or just good?
Yeah,
there's a light, okay. Or not. Let's just watch. Not complicate ourselves. Yep, that's right. Okay.
Blackfire began mining for barite in early 2008, when community discontent in Chico Muselo was already apparent. The company was grateful to the Canadian Embassy in Mexico for helping it obtain a final permit from Mexican authorities. As a local resident and founding member of the Mexican Network of Mining Affected Peoples, Mariano Abarca started speaking out in 2008 about the current and potential impacts of the mine on rivers and land.
Tenemos conocimiento del, ahora sí, del daño que está ocasionando también ya en algunas partes por esta actividad de lo, del, del municipio, este, específicamente en el ejido Nueva Morelia, donde ya hay unas partiduras, unas grietas, este, por la cantidad de explosivos que están utilizando.
Mariano and family members were robbed and beaten by employees of the mine in August 2008. He registered a complaint, but the state ignored it until after his murder. In June 2009, Mariano and other Chico Museo community members began a peaceful protest. For the mine to be permanently closed. In July, they demonstrated outside Canada's embassy in Mexico City to draw attention to their struggle.
Sí, donde está mirando la gente, además del conflicto social que se vive ya en el ejido, porque la compañía está utilizando a los trabajadores, sus trabajadores como grupos de choque.
To discredit Mariano, Blackfire accused him of organized crime and other wrongdoings. Mariano was taken into police custody for 8 days without charge in August 2009, his whereabouts kept secret from family and friends. Released following an international campaign directed at the Mexican state and the Canadian embassy, he continued to receive threats. A few days after making yet another complaint, he was murdered in broad daylight in front of his house on November 27, 2009. All suspects are linked to Blackfire exploration. The lack of a full and impartial investigation means that no one is currently under arrest for his murder.
And then we'll hear a bit more about context in Chiapas from Libertad Díaz. some of the current threats that communities are facing, and Miguel Mijangos will conclude with some comments about some of the broader struggle in Mexico as well. So, Jose Luis?
Buenas noches, tengan todos ustedes.
Good evening, everyone.
Como acabamos de ver, este video muestra un poco muy general de la lucha que mantenía mi padre Mariano Abarca en Chicomucelo, Chiapas, al sur de México.
The video you just saw gives you a bit of an idea of the struggle my father Mariano Abarca was involved in the state of Chiapas in the south of Mexico.
La lucha se empieza cuando la empresa minera canadiense empieza a corromper nuestras autoridades y a ocasionar daños ambientales en las comunidades.
The struggle began when this Canadian company, Blackfire Exploration, started to corrupt some of our local officials and also through its activities started to damage a number of the elements of our natural environment in the area.
La empresa minera de forma estratégica entra a nuestra comunidad, a Chicomucelo, con un programa de desarrollo para la comunidad.
The company arrived thinking very strategically with a whole sort of program of community development.
Que en 3 años estuvo de manera extrayendo el mineral, hubo un desequilibrio en el tejido social y la muerte de mi padre.
But in fact, in the 3 years that they were there engaging in their extractive activities and operating the mine, what we saw was an increasing lack of balance in the social fabric, and also a number of human rights violations, the worst of which, of course, being the assassination of my father.
Eso significa que no existe ningún desarrollo en favor de la minería. Todo lo contrario.
Which means, in fact, that mining didn't bring development to our community, it brought the opposite.
Aparte de corromper a nuestras autoridades, forman grupos de choque, como lo mencionaba él en el video. Él se refiere a personas que se encuentran haciendo cosas ilícitas, a la delincuencia organizada, que se dedican a la drogadicción, al narcotráfico. Forman este grupo para intimidar a las comunidades.
And what we saw from the company was a concerted attempt to organize groups of thugs, essentially people that they drew on from organized crime, people involved in the drug trade and others, other illicit activities that they used to then intimidate and threaten those in the community who were resisting the mine's presence there.
Fue así como en el 2008, mi padre y yo tiene un restaurante, y en esa ocasión estaba yo mesereando, sirviendo, y llegó el grupo de choque al restaurante y empezaron a agredir verbalmente, a intimidar y hasta llegar hasta los golpes. Me golpearon, golpearon a mi padre, todos, tres de ellos son trabajadores de la empresa.
And so it was that in 2008, I was working at our family restaurant. My father and our family ran a restaurant, and I was there working as a server that day, and a group of these thugs arrived and entered the restaurant and began to assault us and intimidate us verbally, and then began to beat us. I was beaten, my father was beaten, So that was the first serious incident of this kind.
Con todo el apoyo del presidente municipal, como el respaldo de la empresa minera, este grupo de choque e intimidaba a la sociedad, como lo que pasó en mi familia. Demandamos ante la justicia en México, pero no continuó, ¿no? O sea, trataron de dejaron las cosas de esa forma sin que pasara nada.
Three of the members of this group were mine employees of the mine, and the group also, this group of thugs, received support from the president of the municipality. We of course achieve some kind of justice in this case through the Mexican court system, but this was an unsuccessful attempt, and we were not able to take the case very far.
En su momento se presentaron cheques que los directivos o que la empresa minera canadiense, la Blackfire, depositaba a su cuenta personal del presidente municipal para establecer la paz en el municipio.
There were cases of blatant corruption. The company Blackfire Exploration would deposit large sums of money, checks, into the personal account of the municipal president, and then ask him to pacify, to calm in the community.
El bloqueo se realiza en el centro o en la cabecera, en el centro de la comunidad, una calle para que no transitaran los camiones, como eran demasiados pesados, estos provocaban daños en las casas. Las calles allá son muy muy pequeñas, muy angostas, y hacía habían demasiadas afectaciones a las casas. También de igual forma transitaban sobre calles donde habían escuelas, y eso provocaba peligro para la comunidad.
One of our means of resistance in the community was to set up a blockade. We set up a blockade in the center of town, actually, and this was mostly to stop the heavy machinery and large trucks from coming through. They were causing a lot of damage to our roads, to people's homes. Many of them were going down streets where there were schools and other important pieces of public infrastructure that were being damaged. So we set up a blockade.
Chicomocelo cuenta con unos 30,000 habitantes aproximadamente.
Chicomocelo has a population of about 30,000.
El ejido donde ellos extraían el mineral llamado barita está como unos 10 kilómetros, 15 kilómetros.
And the parcel of land where they were extracting the barite, the mineral that they were mining, is about 10 kilometers away from the town.
Ellos ingresan con ese modelo de desarrollo, no hacen contratos con las comunidades, hay afectaciones, empiezan a haber afectaciones al poco tiempo de que ellos hacen contratos.
They arrived in the community and didn't carry out any proper consultation. There was no agreement signed which consent was given by the community for this development. Of course, all along they claimed that that's what they were bringing to us. That's what their model claims to bring to communities, development and progress. But in fact, what we saw was quite to the contrary.
En poco tiempo se estaba empezando a suscitar este tipo de peligros en la sociedad. Y fue así como mi padre empezó a levantar la voz, a denunciar los hechos que estaban poniendo en riesgo la vida de las personas.
And it was because of the increased danger that people in the community were living with, and also the environmental impacts we were seeing from this mining development, that my father decided to raise his voice, decided to become a leader in this movement, in this struggle against Blackfire Exploration.
con toda esta impunidad, la empresa minera se estableció, impunidad y corrupción se establece en Chicomucelo.
And two important tools used by the company were impunity and corruption.
Fue así como mi padre empezó por continuar denunciando, aun cuando en el 2008 a mi padre y a mí nos habían golpeado, nos habían amenazado de muerte. Mi padre hizo la denuncia ante la embajada canadiense en México.
But my father continued to raise his voice, not back down, even when we were threatened, even when we were beaten at our restaurant. And in fact, at a certain point, my father brought a complaint to the Canadian embassy.
Después de haber llegado a la embajada y denunciar cómo la empresa minera canadiense estaba formando un grupo de choques para intimidar a su lucha.
And after this complaint was made, after my father had gone to the embassy and described what was going on in the community, that the company had organized these groups of thugs to intimidate people, and the different ways in which they were having a negative impact in the community. After that,
un año después, en el 2009, en agosto del 2009, la empresa minera inventa cargos en contra de mi padre y lo encarcelan por 9 días.
In August of 2009, the company came up with some made up charges and had my father arrested and imprisoned for 9 days.
Gracias al apoyo de las organizaciones nacionales como internacionales, se logró su libertad.
Thanks to support from national organizations and a number of international organizations as well, we were able to have him freed.
Para nosotros, como familia y en la lucha, es importante el apoyo de todas las organizaciones.
For us, the support we've received from many organizations has been very, very important, both for my family and also for our wider struggle in the community.
Después de que él recupera la libertad, se lleva a cabo el primer encuentro en contra del modelo extractivo de la minería en Chicomucelo.
After he was freed from jail, we organized the first gathering of this movement opposed to the extractive model of development in Chicomucelo.
Eso significaba que después de habernos golpeado en el 2008, haberlo intimidado y encarcelado en el 2009, el 27 de noviembre del 2009, de ese mismo año, lo matan frente al en el restaurante que teníamos.
So after having been beaten and intimidated throughout 2008 and 2009, and arrested and imprisoned, it was then in November of that year of 2009 that he was assassinated, that he was murdered in front of our restaurant.
Cinco horas antes que lo asesinaran, llegó el gerente de las relaciones públicas de la empresa a buscarlo al restaurante.
4 hours before he was murdered, the person responsible for public relations at the company at Blackfire came to the restaurant to seek him out.
Posteriormente, 2 horas antes, encuentran a mi papá y empiezan a dialogar.
2 hours before, they had met my father and this person and had discussed a number of matters, had dialogued.
Y aproximadamente como a las 7 o 8 de la noche lo asesinan.
And then at 7 or 8 in the evening, he was killed.
Y se detienen y fueron personas vinculadas a la empresa minera.
And this act was carried out, the killing was carried out by people who were linked to the company.
Es por ese motivo que nosotros hemos tratado de seguir exigiendo justicia como familia y como organización.
This is why we've continued as a family and as a movement, as an organization, to demand justice and to try to seek justice for my father.
Por la falta de justicia que existe en nuestro país.
For the lack of justice in our country.
Hemos acudido ante la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos.
We have taken the case to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights.
hemos solicitado la intervención al comisionado para que investigue el comisionado administrativo público de Canadá para que investigue la conducta de la embajada canadiense toda vez que esta tenía conocimiento.
And we've also brought this complaint to the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner of Canada to hopefully have that office investigate the role that the Canadian Embassy played in supporting and counseling the company in this case.
Es por eso que nos encontramos aquí en Canadá exigiendo justicia y responsabilidad por parte de la embajada canadiense en México, que pudo haber evitado y sobre todo que hubiese limitado el respaldo de la empresa minera con la que estaba actuando en Chicomucel.
And that's what brings me and brings us to Mexico on this visit to demand justice and accountability for the role that the Canadian Embassy played, because they had knowledge, ample knowledge of the degree to which Mariano Abarca was in danger, and they, instead of trying to protect or defend him or play a role that would have lessened the risk or danger, they in fact supported and backed the company.
Seguiremos exigiendo justicia.
And we will continue to demand justice.
Gracias.
Thank you.
To hear just a bit more about how it is that we understand that the embassy played a role and violated some of its own policies and through its own acts and omissions created greater danger to the life of Mariano Abarca and others. Entonces, si Miguel Ángel quiere como explicar un poco más acerca del caso que vamos a presentar acá ante el comisionado.
Sí, claro. Gracias. Bueno, acabamos de escuchar el testimonio de José Luis Abarca.
You just heard the testimony of José Luis Abarca.
Quien ha comentado un poco el contexto en que fue asesinado Mariano Abarca Robledo,
who's described to you somewhat the context in which Mariano Abarca Robledo was killed.
Sin embargo, vale la pena clarificar cuál fue el rol que jugó la misión diplomática canadiense en el proceso que siguió la operación de la mina canadiense Blackfire Exploration, así como el asesinato de Mariano Abarca.
It's important though to provide even more clarity and give you a few more details about the specific role that the Canadian Embassy played, not only in supporting the operations of Blackfire Exploration in Chicomucela, Chiapas, Mexico, but also in the eventual assassination of Mariano Abarca.
La misión diplomática representa al Estado canadiense en México.
Canada's diplomatic mission represents the Canadian government in Mexico.
Y sus atribuciones se encuentran previstas en una norma internacional que es la Convención de Viena sobre Relaciones Diplomáticas.
And its behavior, the way it conducts itself, must respect or is circumscribed by the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations.
Ese tratado establece que la misión diplomática tiene el derecho de proteger los intereses de las personas físicas y morales de nacionalidad canadiense siempre y cuando se respeten los límites que establece el mismo derecho internacional público.
And this convention very clearly says that the Canadian diplomatic mission, the Canadian embassy and its officials have the right to protect and defend the interests of Canadian persons, whether they be physical persons or moral persons, as long as they respect the limits imposed by international law.
Sin embargo, en este caso, no se respetaron tales límites.
However, in this case, those limits were not respected.
La acción de la misión diplomática fue más allá y se comprometió de tal modo con los intereses de la empresa Blackfire Exploration que hizo suyos los reclamos de la empresa para con el gobierno mexicano, en particular el gobierno de Chiapas.
In this case, they went far beyond those limits. The Canadian embassy committed itself quite staunchly on the side of the company and represented and counseled and advised and defended and lobbied for the corporation with the Mexican state and in particular with the authorities in the state of Chiapas.
Se ha documentado que la misión diplomática llevó a cabo numerosas reuniones directas, personales, con funcionarios del gobierno de Chiapas, incluso con el gobernador del estado.
It's been documented that officials of the Canadian embassy met on numerous occasions with senior officials and political leaders in the government of the state of Chiapas, including with the governor himself.
Además de numerosas comunicaciones directas y vía correo electrónico que estableció con los representantes de la empresa.
It's also been documented that they communicated amply with the corporation as well, with the company Blackfire, there are a number of emails. There's a long paper trail to show the nature of this communication and the support they provided to the company.
De hecho, cuando la empresa necesitaba, acudía personal de la misión diplomática a Chiapas para que le ayudara, para ayudar a la empresa a facilitar sus operaciones.
In fact, so friendly was the relationship that the company didn't hesitate to ask and invite officials from the Canadian embassy to come to Chiapas when it needed a little bit of backing up, someone to open some doors and organize meetings and make sure that they were seen by the right people.
Por ejemplo, cuando la empresa tuvo problemas con las comunidades inconformes con la actividad minera, personal de la misión diplomática acudió a Chiapas para llevar a cabo reuniones con autoridades del gobierno y pedirles que actuaran para quitar esos obstáculos que representaban las comunidades inconformes.
For example, when communities would raise their voices against activities of the company, against a particular mining project or concession or proposal, the officials of the Canadian embassy would be invited down by Blackfire to organize meetings in which the company and those officials would tell leaders within the Chiapas government to remove those obstacles and to make things smoother for the company.
El nivel de involucramiento, la presencia directa que tuvo la misión diplomática con las acciones de la empresa indican que conoció a la perfección que la empresa estaba llevando a cabo acciones de corrupción para facilitar sus operaciones.
And it's become clear because of the closeness of this relationship, the degree to which the embassy was involved with the company, that they were aware of the use of corruption by the company through bribes and payments to the personal bank account of the municipal president and other forms of corruption that were being used. The embassy was aware of this.
Durante muchos meses, incluso años, la empresa estuvo pagando una cantidad de dinero al presidente municipal de Chicomucelo, municipio donde operaba la empresa, para que el alcalde facilitara la operación de la empresa y ayudara a evitar que las comunidades, que los habitantes inconformes, no obstaculizaran el trabajo de la empresa.
And the embassy also knew, and what became clear was that the company was making regular payments to the personal bank account of the municipal president, of the mayor, who was in return asked to again remove any obstacles, remove any troublemakers, those who were providing resistance and offering resistance to the activities of the company.
Todas estas acciones que llevó a cabo la empresa minera, por un lado, con el respaldo, con el apoyo, la asesoría incluso de la misión diplomática, se dieron en un contexto de alto riesgo para la seguridad y la vida de Mariano Abarca.
All of this cooperation between the embassy and the company, all of the support provided, the counsel provided by officials of the embassy for the company, this was all done in a context in which the life of Mariano Abarca was very much at risk.
Y la embajada sabía perfectamente que Mariano Abarca corría riesgo, que su vida estaba en peligro.
And the embassy knew perfectly well that Mariano Abarca's life was at risk, that he was in danger.
Lo sabía porque estaba involucrada y porque Mariano Abarca acudió a la misión diplomática a denunciar, a pedir apoyo ante el riesgo para su vida.
The embassy knew not only because they were so involved with the company and so up on this file, but also because Mariano Abarca had gone in person to the Canadian embassy in Mexico City to ask for protection and to ask for support.
De manera que en nuestra perspectiva, la misión diplomática fue más allá de los límites que le permite su actuar como representantes diplomáticos de Canadá.
So from our point of view, the Canadian embassy went well beyond the role of an embassy, which is rightfully to represent its country in another country. That's fine, but in this case, the embassy went well beyond that in an inappropriate way.
Entonces, no solo ha violado leyes internacionales, sino también leyes nacionales que prohíben que los funcionarios públicos canadienses en el extranjero actúen en contextos en que la vida de los defensores de derechos humanos, de defensores ambientalistas, se encuentra en riesgo.
And so not only did they violate international law, but they also violated Canadian national domestic laws, which say that representatives of Canada are not to act in a way that puts defenders of human rights and environmental defenders in danger or contribute to them being put in danger or at risk.
Y tampoco cumplieron con las leyes de Canadá que establecen que los funcionarios deben abstenerse de intervenir en aquellos casos en que se encuentran involucradas conductas de corrupción, como acabamos de mencionar.
Nor did they follow Canadian law, which also clearly says that representatives, diplomatic representatives of Canada, are not to involve themselves in situations or with companies or other entities that are involved in wrongdoing, particularly corruption and
Nosotros hemos venido a denunciar, pero también queremos que la sociedad canadiense sepa lo que están haciendo sus funcionarios en el extranjero y sepan que en el nombre del Estado de Canadá ellos están actuando y violando derechos humanos.
So we are here to denounce the situation, but we are also here make Canadians aware, to make all of you aware of what people are doing in your name, on your behalf, your representatives, the representatives of your state, of your government, and that they are involving themselves in situations that lead to the violation of the fundamental human rights of people in countries where they are.
Creemos que, por supuesto, eso es del interés público de la sociedad canadiense, conocer estos hechos y que se investiguen adecuadamente. Por eso hemos acudido ante el comisionado.
And we do this also because we fundamentally believe that this is in the public interest of Canada too, not just in our interest, in the interest of all Canadians to know that this is happening, and that's why we want it to be investigated, and that's why we have made our submission, our complaint yesterday. We dropped off the complaint at the Public Sector Integrity Commission's office.
Pero también porque queremos que, como resultado de esta investigación, puedan emitirse recomendaciones dirigidas a evitar que en el futuro puedan volver a presentarse casos tan lamentables como los que estamos mencionando.
And we also want there to be recommendations made as a result of this effort, recommendations that will avoid this kind of situation in the future.
Porque tenemos que decirlo, no es un caso exclusivo de Chiapas.
Because it must be said, this is not a unique or particularly extraordinary case, this case in Chiapas.
Está sucediendo lo mismo en otros estados de México, como Guerrero. Está sucediendo también en otros países, como Guatemala. Y el patrón es el mismo.
This kind of thing is happening in other parts of Mexico, in other states in Mexico. It's happening in other countries like Guatemala, and the pattern seems to be very similar in each case.
La misión diplomática parece no actuar en el interés del Estado, sino en el único y exclusivo interés de las empresas, como la Blackfire Exploration.
Diplomatic mission of Canada, the embassy, often seems to act not in the interest of the state, but in the interest of a company.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Miguel Angel. And we won't get into it right now, but at the end, part of our objective of this evening and the coming public events that the delegation will have during this week is to share some ways that you can support the complaint that has been brought to the commissioner yesterday, and we'll run through those after we hear from Libertad and Miguel a little bit more about the broader context. First in Chiapas, Libertad's going to talk to us a little bit about the extractivism in the context of Chiapas, and then Miguel will give us a wider picture of
Bueno, buenas noches. Muchas gracias por la invitación acá a la universidad. Mi nombre es Libertad Díaz. Somos una organización que se llama Otros Mundos Chiapas.
My name is Libertad Díaz and I come from an organization called Otros Mundos Chiapas.
Somos una organización de la sociedad civil de México que, pues, tenemos el objetivo de crear información de cómo el modelo extractivo se implementa en los territorios, para informar a las comunidades y prevenir y aportar para su defensa del territorio.
We're a Mexican civil society organization that works with communities to tell them about the extractive model and what will happen when this model comes into the community.
Bueno, lo primero que nosotros queremos decir es que este caso de Mariano Abarca, el asesinato de Mariano Abarca, se da un contexto primero mundial. esta criminalización de la protesta, estos ataques que hay hacia los campesinos y a las campesinas, a la población indígena de México y de Latinoamérica, responde a un modelo económico en el que cada vez más las industrias buscan los bienes naturales de los bienes naturales del agua, la tierra, el aire, ¿no?
The first thing that I'd like to say is that this the murder of Mariano Abarca in Chicomucelas is part of something that's happening on a world level. It's a model in which these companies are coming into communities and trying to take out the natural resources, make use of the land, make use of the environment.
En la organización decimos que estamos viviendo un modelo corporación-nación, es decir, hay un evidente contubernio y una evidente organización de las empresas con los estados de los países.
And what we call this model is a complicity between corporations and the states, that they become the same and against the interests of the people.
Las empresas no podrían operar ni extraer todos los bienes naturales si no es por todos los tratados internacionales que se están dando.
The extractive industry wouldn't be able to take out all the natural resources if the international treaties that allow for it didn't exist.
Y por la transformación de las leyes en nuestros países.
Another important factor here is the way that the legal framework in our country has been changing. Is this mic not on?
No, it's on. You need to get closer.
Oh, it's because it's too low. Okay, can you hear me better now?
No.
Closer.
There
it's better. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Bueno, tan solo en México tenemos un desarrollo de neoliberalismo de, pues, por lo menos unos 20 años.
In Mexico, for the last 20 years, neoliberalism has been developing.
Y los últimos 10 años ha acrecentado todavía más.
And the last 10 years, this tendency has grown.
Bueno, tan solo en el 2013... se dio el proceso de las reformas estructurales en México.
There were structural reforms in Mexico in 2013.
Y estas reformas estructurales implicaron todo un paquete de modificación a leyes.
And this brought in a reform of the legal system.
Que reconfiguran el territorio. Básicamente es ¿Cómo cambiamos el modelo energético en México? Es decir, ¿cómo se extrae más petróleo y gas en México?
This shows how the energy model in Mexico has changed and how now it's possible to extract more oil and gas.
Desde hidroeléctricas, básicamente, y bueno, pozos petroleros. Ustedes saben, México es uno de los principales países de donde se extrae petróleo.
As you know, Mexico is one of the primary producers of oil in the world, and most of this comes from hydroelectric and extraction from oil directly from the ground.
Estas reformas estructurales vienen además acompañadas de leyes para la militarización del país.
The structural reforms are accompanied by laws that lead to the militarization of the country.
Apenas este año se aprobó la Ley de Seguridad Nacional, donde todo el aparato militar estará enfocado en proteger a las empresas que extraen minerales y petróleo y gas.
And the national security law has allowed the entire military apparatus to concentrate on the protection of the extractive industry, those who take out minerals and oil and gas from the land.
Aquí solo muestro el mapa de México. Y bueno, este mapa lo muestro para enseñar la región sur-sureste, que es donde se encuentra el estado de Chiapas.
Here in the, you're looking at the map of Mexico, and in the southeast, where she was just pointing, is the area of Chiapas.
Esta región sur-sureste está catalogada para el gobierno mexicano y para las empresas como una región geoestratégica para la extracción de los bienes naturales.
This area of Mexico has been categorized by the government and by the companies as geostrategic for the extraction of minerals and oil and gas.
Bueno, en Chiapas tenemos Chiapas, Guerrero, Veracruz, Oaxaca, que es la región sur-sureste, tenemos la mayor población indígena en México. Y es justo donde se encuentran pues la mayoría de los bienes naturales para la generación de energía y minerales.
Chiapas, Guerrero, Oaxaca,
Guerrero, Oaxaca, Veracruz.
And Veracruz are the areas that are the most heavily populated by indigenous peoples and also the areas where that are targeted for the extraction of minerals, oil and gas.
Este es nuestro territorio para las empresas y para los gobiernos, incluyendo las embajadas.
Este
es nuestro territorio para las empresas y el gobierno.
Okay. On this map, what you see are the different companies and the different local governments.
Entonces, bueno, en nuestro territorio tenemos todo lo que está en amarillo son las concesiones mineras.
Everything in yellow are mining concessions.
Tenemos hidroeléctricas.
Hydroelectric projects.
Proyectos de geotermia.
Geothermic projects.
Y todos los corredores biológicos que para la industria básicamente alemana son los territorios donde se puede extraer la genética de nuestra naturaleza.
And that's where we see the biological corridors that where the German companies are working on taking away our biodiversity.
Chicomucelo se encuentra en una área fronteriza.
Chicomucelo is very close to the border.
Que ahora es parte del programa Frontera Sur.
And it's part of the program called Frontera Sur, the southern bound, the southern border project.
Que es un acuerdo que firman los países del norte, sobre todo Estados Unidos, con México, para incrementar la seguridad militar, para no permitir la migración.
And it's a project that was an agreement between the United States and Mexico to militarize this area and thereby reduce the number of immigrants who can come up from the south.
Bueno, pues qué hay en Chiapas? Básicamente agua, montañas, mucha tierra y muchas poblaciones que aún todavía les falta información sobre todas estas políticas.
What is there in Chiapas? Basically, there's water, there's mountains, there's lots of land and people who do not have information about all these projects that are coming our way.
Bueno, ya Miguel hablará un poco más sobre la minería. Nada más decir que en México, en Chiapas, pues tenemos al menos el 14% del territorio concesionado para la minería.
Miguel will be talking a little bit about the more general mining situation, but in Chiapas, 14% of the territory has been conceded to these mines.
Y bueno, pues ya con el conflicto que ha sucedido en Chicomucelo y bueno, el asesinato de Mariano Abarca ha impulsado a las comunidades para que ahora sepan que estas enfermedades que tienen los niños y las niñas en la costa también son responsabilidad de la minería.
And with the death, the murder of Mariano Abarca in Chicomucelas, and with the situation throughout the regions, we're trying to communicate more and more to people what mining can actually mean. For example, it could mean this kind of disease in the children who live in the coastal areas. There have been a number of children who've been had this kind of disease because of the mining operations in the area.
Estas son solo dos fotografías que tenemos de una comunidad que se defiende, que está en la región de la costa de Chiapas.
These pictures come from the coastal area of Chiapas, in a community where the people are trying to defend themselves against the mining projects.
Viene de una minería, una minera que explota titanio.
And in this case, it's titanium that's being taken from the ground in this mining project.
Que comenzó un proyecto de explotación de más o menos alrededor de 3 años.
It began to operate about 3 years ago.
Y se fue y dejó estas consecuencias en la población.
When it left all these consequences that are mentioned here with the people.
En Chiapas tenemos además ahora 12 pozos petroleros que se quieren explotar.
There are now 12 areas where they are taking oil out of the ground.
Y donde también las empresas canadienses están implicadas.
And Canadian companies are involved in this.
Entonces, estas fotos que tienen aquí son algunas fotos de la población de Chiapas que sigue defendiendo su territorio. Ahora cada vez más la población sabe de los impactos de las industrias en los territorios.
These pictures show how people are trying to defend themselves against the mining industry in Chiapas, and the people are more and more aware of what it means to have to face the mining industry.
Y la solidaridad que podamos tener a nivel internacional es muy importante.
International solidarity is extremely important for us.
Porque la población no va a dejar de luchar y de no dejará de luchar y va a seguir defendiendo lo que les corresponde.
The population will continue to fight and to defend its land, its water, its territory.
La población que defiende su territorio está cada vez más en riesgo.
Of course, the people who are defending the territory are at greater and greater risk.
Y los casos como el de Mariano Abarca van a aumentar.
And we're going to see more and more cases like the case of Mariano Abarca. Can you hear me now? Am I speaking? Okay. Mm-hmm.
Violence and the risks to human rights defenders and people who are merely trying to get by their day to day is becoming ever more difficult.
Bueno, quiero empezar al revés mi presentación.
So I would like to begin my presentation in a reverse order.
Me parece que es muy importante que de aquí nos vayamos un poco agitados, ¿no? En función de lo que estamos pasando.
Because I think that it's important that we all leave this room tonight feeling distressed, feeling somewhat angry.
Y que tiene que ver con el tamaño de los daños que pasan por diferentes matices, diferentes formas.
And this has to do with the level of damage that's being caused, the degree of distress and the impacts that are being created.
Afectando a mujeres y hombres de todas las edades.
Affecting men and women of all ages.
Y que esa es solo una de las expresiones que nos está dejando el modelo extractivo minero.
And what you're seeing here is one expression of what the extractive model is giving us, is leaving behind for us.
Las imágenes que ustedes ven son de tres comunidades, una de Honduras, una de Guatemala y una de México.
The images you're seeing are from three communities in three different countries, Honduras, Guatemala, and Mexico.
Las tres vinculadas con una gran transnacional canadiense que es la Goldcorp.
And all three related to the activities of a very large Canadian transnational called Goldcorp.
Que en el contexto del modelo global es la que más premios tiene de responsabilidad social corporativa.
Which, on a global scale, has won more corporate social responsibility awards than any other company.
Se acaba de incorporar, en el caso de México, al estándar de oro libre de conflictos.
It has achieved, in fact, for itself a new standard that it can affix to its product, which is conflict-free standard.
Ha ganado muchísimas veces el casco de plata por su buena labor que tiene para con los trabajadores.
It's won de la empresa. On a number of occasions the golden helmet for the way it treats its workers and the relationship it has with its workers.
Y es una de las empresas que hoy domina de alguna manera en términos de cantidad y en términos de índice de rentabilidad la extracción de oro.
And it's also one of the companies that has achieved the greatest amount of efficiency in terms of extraction of gold in the world.
Entonces, una de las expresiones del modelo extractivo tiene que ver con los daños a la salud de forma directa.
So one of the ways in which the extractive model expresses itself, or one of its consequences, is in direct impacts on health.
Problemas de oídos, gastrointestinales,
hearing, gastrointestinal problems,
de pelo,
problems with hair,
neurosis,
respiratorios, respiratory issues,
deformaciones, abortos, partos prematuros,
abortions, premature births,
que al final están asociados a la actividad como tal,
which are related directly to the mining activity itself.
En el colmo del cinismo, en México, a esta empresa le han dado el certificado de industria limpia.
And in the height of cynicism, this company has been given the moniker of a clean industry, a clean company, or a green company.
Este es el mapa de México. Todo lo que ven en puntos azules, grises y rosas son las concesiones que el gobierno federal mexicano ha entregado a las empresas privadas, ya sea de capital nacional o de capital extranjero.
This is a map of Mexico, and what you see here in pink and blue and in gray, all those spots and blotches are all of the concessions that have been given by the federal government of Mexico to companies both national and transnational.
Estamos hablando de cerca de 30,000 concesiones.
We're talking here about 30,000 concessions.
Que en el mejor de los casos están ocupando una tercera parte de nuestro país.
Which would occupy about a third of the territory, the national territory of the country.
Si a esto le agregamos los otros componentes que Libertad nos decía en Chiapas, con el petróleo, con el fracking, con las presas, con las reservas de la biosfera.
If we add to this fracking activities, the petrochemical industry, petroleum extraction, hydroelectric dams, and also nature reserves and biological reserves that are being used for various genetic industries.
Estamos hablando de que cerca del 70% de nuestro país ha sido entregado a empresas privadas de capitales privados.
Then we're talking about 70% of the territory of the country of Mexico that has been given over to private interests, to private companies, and to capital.
En ese contexto de despojo del territorio, es normal que haya resistencias.
And I think in this context, in this kind of a way of treating the land and the territory of a country, resistance is only to be expected. Resistance is very natural.
pero resulta muy deprimente que gobiernos como el de Canadá, que presume, ¿no?, una política verde en el tema minero, sea uno de los precursores, no solo de lo que pasa en México, sino son los que literalmente elaboraron la ley minera que opera prácticamente en América Latina.
And so it's quite depressing to see that in this reality, in this context, Canada, actually a country that claims to be a green, sustainable, and progressive country, is actually one of the leaders and one of the precursors and one of the greatest promoters of this model, this extractive model, and also has been very much involved with and responsible for the drafting of mining laws throughout the hemisphere in all of Latin America, the current mining legislation that exists in most Latin American countries.
Todas las embajadas de Canadá en Latinoamérica se han vuelto unos grandes animadores de la inversión privada.
All of the Canadian embassies in Latin America have become great and dynamic facilitators of foreign investment, of Canadian investment in these countries.
Y gastan una buena cantidad de dinero en su promoción a partir de establecer kits informativos que llegan como la parte de arriba hasta la elaboración de cómics, que son los que llegan a las comunidades donde estamos teniendo estos problemas que ahorita vieron en las fotografías de daños a la salud.
And they spend a significant chunk of their budgets, these embassies, on the publication, the production of manuals and kits and even comic books, very glossy, polished documents that are often sent to these communities where they're trying to convince people of all of the great benefits that mining is going to bring.
No estamos hablando de funcionarios que se corrompen. Estamos hablando de que Canadá tiene una política implementada que permite el saqueo de los bienes naturales y el desplazamiento forzado de las comunidades que habitan en los territorios donde, para mala suerte, tienen riqueza minera.
So let's be clear. In this instance, we're not talking about corruption or the involvement of Canadian officials with situations of corruption. Here we're talking about specific policy of the government of Canada to promote this kind of development, to actively encourage it and to actively sell it abroad.
Y nos indigna como mexicanos que de 293 empresas mineras extranjeras que tengamos en México, 205 sean canadienses.
And it really angers us as Mexicans when we see the degree to which Canada is involved and responsible for this. Of the 293 mining companies active, foreign mining companies active in Mexico, 205 of them are Canadian.
Nos indigna porque desde Canadá hay toda una política vinculada a los códigos voluntarios de responsabilidad social que no nos permite tener acciones de tipo jurídico para agarrar, para atrapar a todas estas irregularidades que suceden, como para poder llevar a los funcionarios a la rendición de cuentas. Todo el marco legal que tenemos son códigos voluntarios.
And it also angers us to see that Canada is a country that largely operates on, and its companies largely operate on the basis of voluntary corporate social responsibility schemes, which have no real teeth and no real mechanisms for companies to be held account. This is the model that Canada exports and promotes abroad and allows its companies to operate under, a model that is very much voluntary and does not allow us in Mexico to hold these companies to account.
Y entonces, este tipo de reuniones, que en este caso están con este mexicano, que es de los que encabeza el gobierno de allá, lo vamos a ver en prácticamente toda Latinoamérica. Todo el cuerpo diplomático canadiense volcado a tratar de establecer, nosotros decimos, pisos planos, lisos, para que la inversión canadiense ruede sin problemas.
And so this kind of gathering, of meeting that you see here of suits on the screen with senior Canadian and Mexican officials, is very much replicated all over Latin America and indeed in other parts of the world as well, where, you know, the full strength of the Canadian diplomatic corps is used to create a smooth and welcoming possible context for this kind of investment and this kind of an extractive model.
Y hoy no importa si estamos hablando de una pequeña empresa como Exelon o estamos hablando de un consorcio poderoso como Goldcorp. Absolutamente todas tienen el mismo comportamiento, no importando en qué parte del país se encuentren operando.
And what's also quite striking is that it doesn't matter whether we're talking about a smaller company like Exelon or a behemoth, a large company like Goldcorp, they all seem to have the same pattern of behavior when they, at least when they are operating in different parts of Mexico.
Todo el tiempo hacen exclamaciones de triunfo cada que llega un proyecto a invertir. Sin embargo,
they
en
make
cada
great triumphant victorious statements about what an investment is going to mean, what a mining project is going to mean for a community or for a region or an area in Mexico.
Sin embargo, en cada uno de esos proyectos tenemos ya históricas luchas donde se ha tratado de recurrir al espacio que se tiene en la ley para poder detener estos proyectos y no se ha logrado.
And yet we have a long historical record now of struggles, of resistance movements in these communities, of people and communities trying to organize, trying to use whatever they could find within the law of the land to hold companies to account, to stop projects, to slow them down, to resist them, but often in vain.
Este caso nos muestra de alguna manera los otros daños que genera la minería. En 15 años se interpusieron recursos, 30 recursos jurídicos, que todos siempre fueron derrumbados por la empresa minera.
This article gives you an idea of precisely what I was speaking about, how over, in this case, over 15 years, there were 30 attempts through the court system, through the legal system, to try to stop a company, and yet in every instance the company found a way around it, found a way to get over that hurdle or that obstacle that was trying to be put in their path by a community trying to stop the development.
Esta minera se instaló en una área natural protegida y además destruyó 400 monumentos diferentes que estaban vinculados al área de expansión de la empresa.
In this case, we're talking about a company that inserted itself in an area that was a naturally protected area, a nature reserve, and also destroyed over 400 monuments of significant heritage value. So that's a particularly egregious case here.
Y mucho de este daño tiene que ver con un artículo a la ley que viene de Canadá que dice que la minería es de uso preferencial por sobre cualquier actividad humana.
And this this aspect of the mining law in Mexico, which actually is a Canadian idea, it comes from Canada. This part of the law says that mining takes precedence over any other use of the land, any other activity. It will always take precedence.
Pero además tenemos otro problema. Mariano, la muerte de Mariano está vinculado a un proceso de una lucha de resistencia, es decir, una comunidad que no quería en su territorio una minera.
But there's another problem here. That is to say that the case of Mariano Abarca is a case where a community did not want the mining company there, did not want that development to take place, and actively fought it, and there was a consensus in the community against it.
Sin embargo, en este caso, los compañeros de La Sierrita hicieron un convenio con la empresa, es decir, era una comunidad que creyó en el progreso y desarrollo que planteaba la empresa, y ni siquiera su convenio, que es un convenio paupérrimo de 20 cláusulas, ha sido cumplido cabalmente por la empresa.
But here we have a case of a community that actually wanted the mining company to come, that welcomed it with open arms, that believed in the progress and development that the company would bring through its development, through its project. And they signed, this community signed an agreement with 20 clauses, 20 articles in the agreement, and then the company promptly ignored them and didn't respect the agreement. So even in cases where community welcomes these companies that they behave poorly.
Cuando la comunidad quiso reclamar, por ejemplo, que le dieran la concesión del comedor que estaba en las cláusulas del convenio y no se lo cumplió, se fueron a paro y fueron violentados por el director de la empresa con golpeadores que metió en un camión que el director de la empresa iba manejando.
In this gruesome case, the workers were demanding access to the cafeteria, the dining area, and on the work site, and refused that, even though it was outlined in the agreement. And so they went on strike and had created a picket line or a blockade. And the president of the company himself drove a bus or was involved in an incident where a bus full of thugs was driven into, plowed into this blockade of people, and many people many of these workers were injured.
El ejido La Sierrita tiene 600,000 acciones, es socio de la empresa, y en la junta directiva ni siquiera tenían voz para poder definir la problemática que tenían.
This agreement that the community of La Sierrita had signed with the company gave community members 600,000 shares. But even though they had 600,000 shares in the company, they had no place at the board table, they had no place at any forum within the company for where decisions are made.
Otro tema vinculado a la minería es el trato que están teniendo hoy los trabajadores en México.
Another issue related to mining has to do with the way workers are treated in this sector in Mexico.
En el mejor de los casos los obligan a trabajar de 10 a 12 horas.
In the best of cases they work 10 to 12 hours a day.
Y muchos de ellos ni siquiera tienen una representación seria de cobertura de sus derechos laborales fundamentales.
And in many cases their basic labor rights are not guaranteed or respected.
Cuando un grupo de trabajadores en el proyecto de la Torex Gold, que se llama Media Luna, sabe que puede asociarse libremente con otro sindicato que los protege mejor, la empresa niega esa asociación, se van a paro, y hoy tenemos 3 trabajadores asesinados, 4 personas más que también han sido asesinadas, que ha sido parte del contubernio que se ha dado entre la empresa y el crimen organizado.
In one case of the Media Luna mine of the Torex Gold company, the workers saw that they could be better represented by another union, and so they sought to associate to organize themselves and form a local in that union. The company said no way. They went on strike, and since that happened, there have been 7 workers assassinated. In various situations, some of the workers who were actually on strike were killed, and these killings have all been linked to the company.
Y termino mi presentación diciendo que Canadá está estimulando de alguna manera todo este proceso de inversión, al mismo tiempo que el mismo Canadá amplía alertas para que no viajen a México y en especial a Guerrero, que es de este proyecto de la Torex Gold que les he estado comentando, lo cual para nosotros es una actitud totalmente racista. Que la inversión de progreso y desarrollo de la industria verde y sustentable llegue, pero que ninguno de ustedes, por favor, se les ocurra pasar por Guerrero porque su vida está en peligro.
And one of the great contradictions in all of this, profound contradictions which we also find to be blatantly racist when you analyze it, is that in these areas of Mexico where Canada is so actively promoting the arrival of its investment, of its mining companies, of its extractive sector to come in and supposedly bring great progress and development, is precisely in these areas where the Canadian government itself on its websites and in other ways tells the citizens of Canada, do not go to these areas, they're too dangerous. So by all means, let's send our companies, but heaven forbid any of you should go to these areas because there is so much conflict and so much blood being spilled.
Tenemos integrantes de las empresas que reconocen, ¿no?, su participación con el crimen organizado. Es decir, no es un tema que esté por abajo. Han salido a la prensa a hacer declaraciones que tienen que pactar con el crimen organizado porque se desarrolló algo que nosotros en el 2009 no teníamos previsto. Teníamos una lucha muy clara entre la minería y las resistencias.
There is also a link to organized crime in many cases. There are senior senior officials in some of these companies who not only is it known that they have links to organized crime and are using relationships with organized crime to achieve certain things, but they sometimes they just blatantly say it. They've been quoted in the press as having cooperated in this way with organized crime. So this is a whole other dimension to the problem. It's not all, only just the corporate actor, the company, and state actors. This is a whole other element as well.
Cada una de estas flechitas representa una de las concesiones que se le ha entregado a mineras, pero sobre todo canadienses. Este es el proyecto de los filos en Carrizalillo, y aquí está el de la Torex Gold de Media Luna.
All of these little white arrows, downward pointing white arrows, are mining concessions in Guerrero, and most of them are Canadian. You can see here the first one that Miguel pointed out is the famous Los Filos site of Goldcorp, and then just above it is the Torex Gold Media Luna site.
Y este es el mapa actual de la violencia que tenemos en el contexto del Cinturón Dorado, donde fluye la inversión de desarrollo y progreso que nos han prometido desde Canadá.
And these red spots represent areas where there are significant where there's significant ongoing conflict and violence, and this whole area is called the Golden Belt area of region of Guerrero, which is supposed to be this great promise of abundance and prosperity and development and progress that is brought by this Canadian model, this Canadian extractive model to our state of Guerrero.
Cada uno de esos puntos representa comunidades que por lo menos una tercera parte de la población ha salido de su territorio. Son comunidades con toque de queda de 6 de la mañana a 7 de la noche. Son comunidades con extorsiones, secuestros y asesinatos.
Each of these red points represents a community where up to a third of the population has had to leave. Sometimes they've been forcibly displaced, sometimes they've had to leave because of the conflict, and there, you know, there's the use of threats, extortion, assassinations. These communities have curfews imposed on them, often from 6 to 7. It's so that's what you're seeing represented by the red dots.
Y entonces, en este marco de impunidad tan terrible que tenemos, llegamos a Canadá y nos encontramos la sorpresa de que ya tenemos al hombre bus encabezando esta posibilidad de que tengamos una ventanilla para presentar quejas.
And so you will understand that it is with somewhat of a with somewhat surprised we were somewhat surprised to arrive in Canada to discover that recently there's been the creation of this new office of the ombudsperson, which apparently gives us a window, a place where we can present our complaints in these situations.
Si este defensor que están nombrando va a seguir teniendo la conducta de los códigos de responsabilidad social, estamos perdidos. Es una ventanilla que no nos va a servir absolutamente para nada.
If this esto, newly created office, this newly created position of the ombudsperson, it intends to continue to use this voluntary model of CSR, of corporate social responsibility, then we don't place much hope in this initiative.
Y con esto concluyo.
And that's
presentación.
Where I
Gracias.
Will conclude. Thank you.
Or comments that any of you might have or want to raise with any of our guests. Just before we get into that, and so we don't forget, I do want to mention, and I'll just bring up again, at the website, how do I get out of here? I just want to bring us back to justiceformariano.net, where you can go and find more information about this case, about the complaint that was brought this week to the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner, who now has 3 months, but basically just to decide whether or not he's going to open an investigation into the role of the Canadian Embassy, whether or not they violated policies, what sort of sanctions or recommendations that he might make. So he's got 3 months to decide whether he's going to take on that investigation, which could then take longer. So what we're urging everyone to start to do is on this site you'll find a sample letter that you can send to down at the bottom, where you can send to the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner to share why you think it's important that he take this case on, why it's in the public interest that this happen. We believe that this is the first complaint that's been brought to this commissioner's office, who's responsible basically for overseeing the values and ethics within the public service writ large, not just the embassy, but other areas of the public service. And so we think it's important that he hears from more organizations and from more individuals about this. And there's also information here about how to tweet Mr. Joe Friday at PSIC_integrity and using the hashtag Justice for Mariano. Every day for the next 10 days, we're going to be putting out new videos. They'll be linked on this website, and you can also find them being tweeted out from @MiningWatch. And so you can retweet those and share them with your networks. And we really hope to provide some support for this initiative that's just been started and undertaken this week. So I just wanted to mention that before opening it up for any questions or comments that y'all might have at the back. And if you can just speak up, we're going to actually maybe, you know what, I'm going to pass around a mic for those that are raising questions. This will help us to ensure.
There's one there.
Oh, good. Okay, there we go. We got a mic. So that we can ensure interpretation for our guests, vice versa. Thanks.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you, speakers, and presenters. And the whole thing is, I have a comment, a quick comment. It's overwhelming. I'm just overwhelmed. I sort of follow this as a human rights activist for many decades, but I'm overwhelmed with the sheer numbers and the sheer scope and the personal story. So thank you for coming and sharing your whole story with us. But on a particular question I have is, on this letter you have, on this procedure here, which is coming through, which I think is brilliant, I think it's good, it's something good. Is it possible here, when you're looking at, you talk about these embassies, but that's a thing. These are people, and you're talking about the mining people. We saw pictures of them. Is it possible to identify them and call them by name publicly in your work? I'm talking in Mining Watch work, to actually identify where, particularly in the case here, of who the ambassador was at the time and who the players were. Like, expose the people involved. These are real civil servants. These are appointed by the government, or the ambassador appointed. Now, so we have real people here. Is it possible to identify them publicly as well as this? And again, thank you for your for everything.
Just quickly on that, the people are identified in the complaint and the people will be reviewed. This is the job of the commissioner to do that. There is a reason, though, that in the complaint and in the public release of the complaint, we're focusing on the embassy more writ large, because there's actually a lot of people who knew and were involved in different elements of the whole process between 2007 and 2010. And we have identified, and it is identified in the complaint, that we think that the key person responsible would be the head of mission. So the ambassador at the time was Ambassador Wyszynski. But we're also very conscious that for us this is the tip of the iceberg. So it's not just about a few individuals. And so we'd like to hopefully generate a bit more discussion about the bigger issue. That's going on here as well, and so that, and fear that if we focus too much on the individuals, then it'll tend to get individualized as opposed to being looking at as a bit more of a systemic issue that we got to talk about in a bigger way.
The Public Sector Integrity Commissioner, I'd just like to know what its function is.
Yeah, the Public Sector Integrity Commissioner was established in 2007 as an independent body to oversee, and basically there was whistleblower legislation established to allow public servants in the first instance to be able to have a place to bring complaints about issues within their units and in their different departments. There is also allowance within this legislation for non-public servants to raise information with the commissioner that who can then decide to investigate in order to then recommend sanctions or recommendations to the head of a department to deal with a given situation or to address a broader problem if they identify a broader issue. That in basic terms, so it's not, once again, we're with a situation where the powers of the commissioner, there are considerable powers to investigate, but the what they can do at the end of the day will be to recommend sanctions and to make recommendations that then is dependent on the head of department to respond, but then that head of department has to respond back to the commissioner to say how far they've gone, and if the commissioner is not happy with that, that can be raised with Parliament. So that's where it's at. It took us a while. We've been struggling for a while to find a place to bring this complaint. So this is a little bit of a first experience for us too, and we're going to see how it goes. And that's one of the reasons too that we really want to have a lot of public support around this, so that it doesn't easily get dropped or ignored. Because we think the issue is too important, and we've actually had a really hard time raising it. So yeah, I hope that.
Hello, thanks for your presentations. My name is Sebastián, I'm from Chile, and I'm amazed of the kind of repeating pattern, because in Chile as well, there's the same process of corruption and threatening communities in Putaendo by some exploration companies, but they don't not only explore, but they're continuously damaging resources while they're supposedly doing only exploration. So I just want to comment that this is a sad surprise of neo-colonial customs, let's say, and well, I would try to bring this message that you have exposed to my country, because people need to be aware and to communicate all these similar situations in all the Americas. So thank you for your presentation.
I just wanted to add as well that just about 2 hours away, Maniwaki Algonquin Reserve, there's also a lot of pollution in the water because of mining. So we do have the issues happening here like crazy. You've got to try to think of solutions or reasons why, as it seems like these mining companies are almost giants that want to stimulate economy because they think that they're bringing in wealth to some sort of, I don't know what, some stock market or something. So I think I try to figure out how to approach that politically. I got no idea, really.
Hi, thanks. First of all, Jose, it's amazing, you know, reading documents about what happened to your father and the circumstances of Blackfire. It's another thing to see you're still fighting for, and that's great. I'm just wondering, I know the Public Sector Integrity Commission, I don't think has had many complaints from outside the public service, they're certainly involving foreign, in part foreign jurisdictions where Canadian officials are taking part. But I'm wondering this week while your group is in, if you've thought of going to the minister herself. She seems much more receptive to people doing that, as well as the Canadian government is engaged in NAFTA negotiations where they claim that they want certain human rights, environmental protections, labor standards written in. So I don't really know whether, I don't know the strategies, but I'm just wondering if there's more to it that could be done during the week.
Perhaps in that response, we actually had some meetings today with a few legislators, also with the Director of Policy for the Minister of International Trade, and some members of Global Affairs Canada responsible for North America. I don't know if perhaps a couple of folks from the delegation maybe want to comment on if there was some openness or how the reception was in the meetings this afternoon in particular. Your decision.
Bueno, sí, tuvimos una reunión con el director de política del Ministerio de Comercio.
Yes, we had a meeting with the policy director of the Minister of International Trade.
Aunque fue una reunión un poco apresurada, tuvimos por lo menos el tiempo de darle a conocer la situación, lo que aquí acabamos de comentar, de compartir.
We didn't have a lot of time with him, but we were able to share with him the facts of this particular case and give him some of the context.
Bueno, lo vimos muy receptivo, entendió la situación y digamos que asumió el compromiso de investigar en la administración pública canadiense cuáles eran los antecedentes del caso, si había archivos, ofreció incluso acceder al expediente del caso, dado que nosotros tuvimos acceso a las comunicaciones que se establecieron entre la embajada y la empresa, o entre la embajada y la administración central también, pero pues obviamente hay partes que están censuradas y él podría tener acceso a las versiones completas. Digo que podría hacerlo, ¿eh? Vamos a estar pendiente con eso. Sugirió también que se le dieran propuestas, pero pues hasta ahí nada más.
So he seemed fairly receptive and open. It's hard to know, we had a fairly brief meeting with him, but he did say that he committed to us that he would look into the case, into this file. He would go back in the archives and the records to see what documents he could find. Of course, he knew because of what we told him that we, in fact, through ATIP, had received a number of documents. Some of them were somewhat redacted, and he said that he might be able to find us some versions of these records that were unredacted, so we could see some of the parts that we didn't get to see. We're talking here about a lot of the communication between the embassy officials and the company, between the embassy and head office in Ottawa, and so on. So he did seem to show some openness and did commit to us that he was going to look into it.
Hi folks, my name is Kevin Skerritt. I want to first just thank the delegation for the presentations. As others have said, very powerful, I think very important for us to hear in Canada. I work for one of the trade unions, QP, and I think QP and certain other union organizations were co-sponsors for this. This relates to my question and the issues that all of this, all of your presentations are raising are obviously human rights issues and environmental issues, but they're also workers' rights issues. And I guess my question in part is to Jen and to Mining Watch about the engagement of Canada's labor movement around these issues. And because, I mean, of course, one of the frustrating things is a lot of this information is not reported in Canada. It is blocked by our mainstream media for the most part. It's not permitted. So most Canadians aren't aware of this, and I think that the best way to get around that is to reach people through our civil society organizations, our trade union movement, and other social movement organizations, like Mining Watch, of course. But, you know, we all depend on the power of mass movement organizations, and the trade union movement is probably the one we have left with some capacity. But so my question is, in some ways, to Jen and others from Mining Watch, you know, to what extent is the trade union movement meaningfully supporting this work and these kinds of projects? And I guess in particular, the work that Mining Watch is engaged in around legislative reform that would establish a higher standard for corporate behavior and corporate conduct. Because I know from knowing Jen that there has been some work to try to establish a stronger legislative framework that could be imposed on these rogue Canadian mining companies. But it has been pushed back by governments. So I mean, I don't know if you have a moment to just explain what that is, where that stands, and the most effective ways that those of us that you know might have some access could be pushing that agenda more effectively.
Yeah, maybe just to start, this delegation has quite strong support from a number of trade unions in Canada, the United Steelworkers, the Public Service Alliance of Canada, CUPE, are all supporting this delegation specifically, and have quite consistently supported these sorts of initiatives. And also Mark Rollison, from assistant to the director of Steelworkers, was with us today. He was one of the delegates that actually went on one of the first fact-finding mission to Chico Bucelo Chiapas back in 2010. That was important to kind of laying some groundwork for the work that's been done since that time internationally. And quite specifically around this complaint, it's actually been interesting, some of the conversations with the Public Service Alliance and I think yet to be had a bit more with CUPE, that especially when we're talking about the values and ethics within the public service, these are things where we actually have some interesting areas for more potential overlap and discussion in terms of what further work we could do moving forward in this area, quite specifically that I think we're just barely beginning the conversation. And there's a lot more conversations to be had. We're fairly aware that this complaint is, I understand it may be one of the like, we're not sure. The commissioner's office has told us there's actually been a fair number of information brought to the commissioner's office from outside of the public service, so it may not be too groundbreaking on that front, but that on, you know, sort of a foreign service piece, that it's a bit new. So I'm looking forward to further conversations with the public service unions in terms of support around this work in particular. Also knowing that this has been a piece of legislation in the commissioner's office that's been set up to try to help workers within the public service. So that there may be an area to explore there. I think more broadly speaking, since its formation, supporting organizations of Mining Watch have been the labor movement. And they have been really involved in the different initiatives that have come up for legislative reform. Where is that at right now? Miguel alluded to it at the end of his presentation. There was an announcement by the Minister of International Trade a couple of weeks ago about the creation of an ombudsman's office sometime in the coming year. There's not a clear time frame around that. Presumably it will be after they phase out the current CSR counselor sometime mid-year. And there's a lot of details waiting to be put. think the piece that, that Miguel really raised concern about is the fact that it's already clear that its powers are going to be limited to recommendations that won't be binding on the companies nor on government. So it'll be once again up to you know, the strength and the power that the communities have to insist that those things be actually abided by, which we know from experience is where things, the rubber really hits the road. What's being disputed right now are the investigative powers of that body, which could go considerably beyond what we currently have if the independence of the ombudsman is assured, and if those investigations are actually robust and have powers to compel documentation and testimony. Again, the value of getting more information, we've been having a bit of a discussion in the last few days, and you know, we don't actually lack, information is not what we lack. It's actually binding accountability measures. So on that piece, it's still a proposal that's falling short in that way. I think that's a challenge to all of us, not just the labor movement or anything. It's a challenge to you know, the bigger fight that we have in this country over these measures. And I think we have to look critically too at the complement, the multi-stakeholder body that's been set up adjoined to that ombudsman that. You know, now the federal government is going to rely on that, where there's a tremendously strong presence of the mining industry, the petroleum industry, the textile industry, with labor union representation and civil society representation too, but that government is now going to go to advise it on its further policy. So I think there's some reason to seriously think critically about how that's going to help or hinder future proposals moving forward and really getting to something that has binding accountability attached to it. And I still think that where some of the, you know, the pieces that are pushing the envelope more on that are some of the civil lawsuits that are moving through the courts right now in Ontario and British Columbia. Those are long processes, they're costly processes, and they're also dangerous processes to the people involved. But nonetheless trying to get to some binding measures that the companies will be forced to deal with. And we know that those are already sending shivers through industry in terms of their potential liability for other harms. And those are cases that are being looked at very closely by affected communities for some of the lessons that they can take for the work. So, yeah. If there's any, no sé si hay algunos comentarios al respecto en torno a la relación con el certificado. Yeah, no. Are there other questions or comments, perhaps? In the back again? Is there another hand? If there's another hand, we'll go to the other hand first, and then we can come back to.
Thank you. I have a quick question. When looking at that map, and I'm just thinking about mining companies and Canadian mining companies and the conditions, everything's shown. I'm just reacting proactive from everything I'm hearing here today. And I've just said to myself, you know, I'm a farmer marine engineer and I'm a farmer blue collar worker, and I've worked in mines. I've worked in the pumps, and I've worked in mines and mining operations in different parts of the world. As an engineer, as a machinist, down below and on. Now there are. I'm just wondering: is there any? Please tell me here. Is there any decent mining operations going on there at all? So what? Just one. Is there any company? Because we have mining in this country. Mining is essential to look. We've got lights. We live bloody phone here. We need mining. You need mining. Is there any decent mining operations in that Mexican area? Are there any decent mining companies? And the other part of it here, what about the ethics of mining? In this university right here, there's universities, mining engineers are trained all over the place. They have a code, they have a culture, they have ethics. What happens to them when they go outside? Is there any redeeming feature about mining? I'm not being cynical here, I'm just reacting.
please, talk to someone, say something, you know.
I'm sure somebody will say something.
Es muy difícil decir algo positivo de cómo hoy el modelo extractivo ha estado posicionándose de los territorios.
It's very hard to find something positive to say about how the current extractive model is positioning itself in various territories.
La empresa Leagold acaba de adquirir cerca de 12,000 hectáreas de una concesión.
The company Leagold has just obtained a concession of 12,000 hectares.
Cada hectárea, la retribución al gobierno mexicano es de $1 al año.
For each hectare, it's going to pay $1 a year to the Mexican government.
La concesión dura 50 años.
The concession will last for 50 years.
La tributación por la extracción del metal que sea, en el caso general, son 7.5% de lo que la empresa puede vender.
The royalties will be royalties coming from what will be taken out of the ground will be 7.5% of what the company may be able to sell.
Es decir, se están llevando un bien nacional literalmente de forma gratuita, y lo único que dejan de costo es si lo venden un porcentaje ínfimo que está vinculado a la utilidad. Es un negocio maravilloso para hacerse rico en 4 o 5 años. Una sola empresa, la de Carrizalillo, al año gana $450 millones.
The company in Carrizalillo makes $450 million a year. What I'm getting at with all of this is that the model is about taking a national treasure, subsurface goods, and basically leaving the country with this wealth and leaving nothing behind. We're talking about infinitely small royalty percentages. And it's just a model that leaves nothing behind for a country where the extraction has taken place.
Y al municipio donde se opera esa empresa solo le deja, ¿cuánto será? 20 millones de pesos. ¿Cuánto es? Un millón de dólares, ¿no? Se lleva 450 al año y solo deja $1 million que no está alcanzando para cuidar los daños en la piel de la población.
So in the case of Carrizalillo, they're making $450 million profits a year, what the municipality gets, the local municipality gets $1 million a year, versus $450 million the company's taking away, and there's no compensation for no funding for dealing with the health issues, the skin conditions you saw on the screen earlier.
La gente que vive en este proyecto solo tiene agua que está fuera de la norma en términos de arsénico para contacto humano. O sea, ni siquiera sirve para lavar la ropa. Sin embargo, es la única agua que tiene.
The only water people in this community have access to now is water that violates all the standards in terms of arsenic content, and it's not even fit for washing clothes with, and actually it's the only water they have access to now.
La empresa utiliza 250 millones de litros de agua diarios, y la comunidad tiene que comprar agua de garrafón para poderse enjuagar los metales pesados que quedan en su cuerpo y sobre todo el arsénico.
¿Cuántos millones?
250 millones de agua
por día.
Sorry, I couldn't believe the numbers, so I had to ask again. 250 million liters of water a day is what the company uses on this site alone. And the people of the community have to line up to buy a plastic container full of water that they can then use to give themselves a sponge bath to wash the heavy metals and arsenic off of their clothing and skin that they're getting from the extraction of this, of these resources.
Es decir, hay una descompensación de origen, hay una destrucción de la naturaleza, por lo tanto, hay una incidencia permanente de daños a la salud. Para que una sola persona se pueda desintoxicar de los metales pesados que están quedando en su sangre, necesita tratamientos que están por arriba de los 70 mil pesos por persona. Pero tiene que además irse de ahí. Eso es a lo que nosotros le llamamos desplazamiento forzado. Ya no hay condiciones para vivir y la única forma que tiene la gente para continuar su vida es que se vaya. Si tiene dinero, se podrá ir a otro lado a desintoxicar. Pero si no tiene dinero, está jodida. Está permanentemente en su tierra esperando la muerte.
So this is the model. It's damaging to the environment, which as a consequence is also very seriously damaging for human health. And when people require treatment because of these skin conditions and other conditions where they have heavy metals in their bloodstream, if they want treatment, that's not offered in their communities. They have to leave, and this is what we mean by forced displacement. People who have the means to leave. They're looking at 70,000 pesos, for a simple treatment. And those, the vast majority who can't, who don't have the means to leave, are stuck there. They're screwed. They just have to stay and suck it up and deal with the consequences.
La minería es una actividad noble, pero implementado bajo la lógica económica en la que hoy está dominando, no solo la minería, sino todo el modelo extractivo, no nos lleva a ningún lado.
Mining can, I agree with you, mining can be a noble industry, it can be a noble pursuit if it's done properly, but done according to the current economic model, the current economic logic that has become dominant in our world, this is what it does, and it's not a positive result.
Les voy a platicar una anécdota de la ridiculez del modelo extractivo. Todos conocemos a la empresa Apple.
I'm going to tell you a little anecdote that demonstrates the ridiculousness of the current extractive model. You all know the company Apple.
Se les ocurrió hace dos años.
It occurred to them 2 years ago.
Hacer un reloj de 18 quilates.
To make an 18 karat watch.
Haciendo los cálculos de la cantidad de onzas que necesita cada reloj, sacaron una edición limitada de 1,000,000 de relojes. Es decir, no es para cualquier gente.
Once they calculated the number of ounces that they needed to make this watch, they realized that this was going to be a limited edition. They were only going to produce 1,000,000 of these watches. So it's not just for anyone. You have to have the means to buy this watch.
Eso implica que ese 1,000,000 de relojes necesita la tercera parte, solo la tercera parte de la producción anual de esta mina, que es la de Carrizalillo, que se llama Los Filos y que está en manos de la Goldcorp.
So, this 1,000,000 watches that Apple wanted to make requires one third of what is produced at the Carrizalillo mine in a year, which is what you see on the screen here, the Carrizalillo site, the Los Filos site of the Gold Corp.
Allá arriba vemos el tamaño de la comunidad.
At the top you see the size of the,
of the
community, of the town site.
De su territorio.
Below it, where you see the name of the town, Carrizalillo, and below it, the size of the imprint of the mine itself.
Es decir, si a nuestras actividades extractivas no les ponemos un límite, no nos va a alcanzar la tierra, no nos va a alcanzar el agua, no nos va a alcanzar el aire, para que todos tengamos el nivel de bienestar que dicen que debemos de tener a partir de lo que nos venden, tenemos que comprar.
So, hoy, this is to say, if you look at the size here, this is to say that there is not enough land, there's not enough water, there's not enough air on this finite planet of ours to satisfy this kind of extractive model that we are sold as necessary, necessary for us to have the things that we are told we need to have and to live the standard of living that we are told we need to live.
Hoy se dice que si recicláramos los metales que están ya literalmente disponibles en la basura, nos evitaríamos un proyecto de este tipo durante los próximos 300 años. Algo está mal.
It's been calculated that if we were to simply recycle and reuse the metals that already exist, that we've already produced from mining in the past, that we could prevent having to build a mine like this for the next 300 years. This is metal that's sitting in landfills and in dumps all across the planet. And we could not have to do this if we just use those resources that we've already made appropriately.
Entonces no es la actividad, ¿no? Es la voracidad de los empresarios que no tienen llenadera para hacerse multimillonarios en poco tiempo a costa de lo que sea. Y han violentado, ¿no?, a todas las naciones con reformas estructurales para que haya permisibilidad para este tipo de proyectos, reduciendo los derechos generales, ¿no?, o violando los derechos generales, en este caso, derechos humanos y colectivos.
So it's the veracity, the greed of those who want to make a quick buck in as efficient a fashion as possible, that allows for this kind of a model of extraction, because mining can be done in a different way. I agree with you, but the model that allows the very few to get very wealthy very quickly is not a sustainable model, and these are the consequences of that model.
Brings a whole new meaning to mining lunch.
I was glad that Jim showed up here.
Gimnasio, that's the Spanish word for gym, the gymnasium.
So we've sort of reached our time. I do want to remind you all to go to the website justiceformariano.net and please share your support. This evening has also been recorded and will be posted on ICLMG.
Yeah, it's already on the event, and I'll get you a link to post on the Mariano for justiceformariano.net website, so it's easy for you all to share.
Super, thank you. And thank you to the International Civil Liberties Monitoring Group for live streaming tonight. Thank you to the Latin American Caribbean Studies Program for helping us put this together. There's a bunch of sponsors for the delegation, QP, the Public Service Alliance of Canada, Interpares, Kairos. It's really been a big group effort. And there's a couple of books here about mining that were put together by Otros Mundos Chiapas, written by Gustavo Castro. I don't know how we're going to decide who gets to take them. ¿Cómo vamos a decidir quién lo compra? We can leave. Maybe with Christian and you guys can share. Okay, that sounds very appropriate. just want to thank also, there's a lot of people to thank our interpreters for this evening that have really made this. And to all of you for coming. So please spread the word, and we'll be putting updates to about the process around the complaint on our website in the coming period, and it'll be a little while before we get much of a concrete response, but